Thank you for taking off on a beautiful day. Lovely, Krakow. Thank you for allowing me to speak to you. I thought we'd start out with the talk on amyloidosis, since that seems to be really the greatest challenge for many of the clinicians. And so I thought I'd run through a little algorithm about how we diagnose and treat amyloidosis. And then if there's time, we'll do the Waldenstrom's and the amyloid. These are my disclosures. These are the learning objectives. It's recognizing amyloid, how to manage amyloid, and then how to decide about what type of therapy we want to give for amyloid. So I'm going to start out by some patient presentations so that we have a good understanding of the types of patients that we're seeing. So this is a 79-year-old man who came because of dyspnea on exertion for a year and lower extremity edema. And the patient, as part of the evaluation, saw a cardiologist who did an echocardiogram. The echocardiogram showed concentric left ventricular hypertrophy, and then the EKG showed an anterior infarction. So the patient had a cardiac catheterization. Cardiac catheterization showed normal coronary arteries, and then the patient was referred to Mayo Clinic for non-cardiac dyspnea. The patient had dyspnea, but the heart was felt to be normal. So we did some imaging studies. The CT scan showed lymphadenopathy in the retroperitoneum, very small sub-centimeter nodes, and these nodes were biopsied laparoscopically, and they showed sinus histiocytosis, which of course is not a diagnosis. But on the serum protein electrophoresis, even though on the serum protein electrophoresis, the albumin and the gamma globulin levels were normal, when you look at the pattern, you can see that there's a very small peak in the gamma globulin, maybe 6 grams per liter at most. The total gamma globulin is normal, but there's clearly a monoclonal peak here. That led to a 24-hour urine protein electrophoresis. You'll note that the 24-hour urine only had 220 milligrams for 24 hours, an insignificant amount of urinary protein, a trivial amount of urinary protein. However, when the protein was electrophoresed, this is where albumin is, and the whole 220 milligrams represented monoclonal light chains migrating in the gamma region. So this patient with, quote, non-cardiac dyspnea had a small monoclonal peak in the serum, small monoclonal peak in the urine, and that triggered the appropriate diagnostic evaluation, because now you have someone with an M spike and dyspnea, and that changes the pattern. Here's the patient's EKG. You can see why they said that was an anterior infarction, because there are QS complexes in V1 and V2, no R waves, but this isn't a true infarction. This is a pseudo-infarction pattern. But of course, you don't know it's a pseudo-infarction until you think about the diagnosis. So we repeated the echo, and our echocardiographer said this is not hypertrophy. The walls are thick, but not hypertrophy. Infiltration of the myocardium and restrictive diastolic filling, high pressures, a stiff heart, and the hypertrophy was reinterpreted as infiltration. And then this patient had a fat aspirate that showed amyloid deposits, and that lymph node that we obtained at the beginning that showed sinus histiocytosis, we went back and stained it with Congo red, and it was positive. And that's the hardest amyloid syndrome to diagnose, our patients with infiltrative cardiomyopathy, repeatedly missed by general physicians, repeatedly overlooked by cardiologists. Here's a patient who came to us from the hematologist, however. This is a patient who was diagnosed as atypical multiple myeloma. The patient had a small IgA lambda monoclonal protein in the serum, 8 grams per liter. And the bone marrow showed less than 10% plasma cells with a normal hemoglobin. The important thing is, what was the patient's clinical syndrome? It was unexplained fatigue, dyspnea on exertion, unable to climb stairs, and would have to walk on the level, and after 55 meters would have to stop. The referring hematologist thought that the patient had some form of endogenous depression, because we said you've got early multiple myeloma. But just on physical examination, the patient had low voltage in the limb leads, a pseudo-infarction pattern, and on physical examination, the patient's jugular veins were distended right to the angle of the jaw because of the profound restricted filling and the high pressures on the right side of the heart. So just on the physical exam, it was pretty clear what this fatigue was in this patient with atypical multiple myeloma. This is just the bone marrow biopsy here, stained with Congo red. You can see the congophilic amorphic eosinophilic material. This is a dual photograph under polarized light demonstrating apple green birefringence. So the bone marrow biopsy from outside held the diagnosis, but one has to think about the possibilities. Third patient, this is a 52-year-old woman who came with a history of progressive sensory as well as motor peripheral neuropathy. The patient had an IgM lambda monoclonal protein, 12 grams per liter, a urinary total protein of just under 1 gram for 24 hours, although almost all of it was monoclonal protein, and the free light chain lambda was very slightly elevated. That's 2.5 times normal. Normal's 2 milligrams per deciliter. The patient was diagnosed by the home hematologist as having chronic inflammatory demyelinating polyneuropathy associated with an IgM monoclonal protein without further investigation. The patient had total plasma exchange without benefit. The patient had immunoglobulin infusions without benefit. The bone marrow showed 30% lymphocytes and 5% plasma cells. The patient was told you have Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia with peripheral neuropathy. And the patient began cyclophosphamide, rituximab, and dexamethasone and received 4 cycles and still was not improved. And then ultimately was referred to Mayo Clinic. We just did a fat aspirate. Here's the fat aspirate. You can see that the fat cells are preserved. You can see the interstices of the fat, and it's all taking up Congo red, intense congophilia. We do polarization microscopy. There's no question that this patient with an MGUS neuropathy really had amyloid neuropathy, but failure to recognize led to a misdiagnosis. When you look at our cohort of 43,000 patients over 50 years, as you imagine, MGUS is clearly the most common. Right now, multiple myeloma is about 18% of our population. Right now, we're seeing in the United States 5 people per 100,000 with multiple myeloma. So 5 per 100,000 to us translates to 20,000 new diagnoses per year. Amyloid is 8 per million per year in the United States. I doubt it would be very different here, and that would translate to 4,000 new diagnoses. So 5 myeloma to 1 amyloid. And then Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia is actually 4 per million per year, which in our country translates into 2,000 new patients. So 20,000 myeloma, 10,000, 4,000 amyloid, 2,000 Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia, 10 to 1 are the ratios that we're currently seeing in our country. When we look about making the diagnosis of amyloid, usually at our center, we don't do heart biopsy or kidney biopsy or liver biopsy. That really is unnecessary. It's usually sufficient to simply do a bone marrow biopsy and a fat aspirate, stain both for Congo red, and in our experience, that'll pick up about 85% of the patients. We'll have one of those two positive with a compatible clinical amyloid syndrome. And the tests are complementary because some people have only one positive. But the bottom line is you don't normally have to do, when you suspect amyloid, a kidney, a liver, a nerve, a heart, a lung biopsy. You can do it non-invasively with a bone marrow or fat. When you look at the symptoms for amyloid, that's really the problem with the diagnosis. If you look at these symptoms, fatigue, edema, weight loss, very nonspecific. You can't look for amyloid every time someone has fatigue or edema. You can look for some of the clinical findings, macroglossia, submandibular swelling, periorbital purpura. The problem is you only see that in about 15% of patients. So if you say, well, I don't think it's amyloid because the tongue's normal and there's no purpura, you miss 85% of the patients. So what I'm really saying is the signs are not very sensitive, although they're specific. And the symptoms are not very sensitive or specific. They're too vague and too general. So you really need to think about amyloid when the patient has either heavy albuminuria, an unexplained cardiomyopathy, an unexplained peripheral neuropathy, unexplained hepatomegaly, or atypical myeloma with a monoclonal protein, probably lambda. I want to talk a little bit about the new diagnostic strategies. One of the problems with amyloid is that every patient who has a biopsy that shows amyloid may not be immunoglobulin light chain amyloid, the type that we're expected to treat with chemotherapy. There are so many other types of localized amyloid, inherited amyloid, senile amyloid, that once you have a positive biopsy for amyloid, the work is not done because we still need to classify what kind of amyloid are we talking about. Historically, immunohistochemistry used to be done. So here's a kidney biopsy. These are the remnants of the glomeruli. You can see the amorphous eosinophilic deposits in the kidney that are conchophilic. And here, using immunohistochemistry, you can see strong lambda light chain uptake. But immunohistochemistry is generally not the best way to identify the type of amyloid. There are a couple problems. First of all, with immunohistochemistry, you use commercial anti-sera against lambda light chains. And with amyloid, that's two problems. Number one, the lambda chains in the amyloid is not the intact lambda-free light chain. It's usually a fragment of the light chain, usually only the variable portion of the immunoglobulin light chain. The constant portion is deleted and may not be recognizable by the anti-sera. Number two, the amyloid protein folds and misfolds, and so oftentimes the epitopes that are exposed to the anti-sera will actually no longer be visible to the antibody, and so you get false negative immunohistochemistry. What we've done is we've substituted mass spectroscopic analysis of all amyloid deposits in an attempt to try and make certain what type of amyloid we're dealing with. So here's an example of mass spec. Here you can see bone marrow. You can see the cellular portion of the bone marrow. You can see the fat in the bone marrow. And right in the middle, you can see a conchophilic deposit. Under fluorescent microscopy, a technician from the slide just does laser microdissection and pulls it right off the slide. So this drops off the slide right into a test tube. When it's in the test tube, it undergoes mass spec analysis. That actually sequences the protein and then compares it by a computer to a library of known proteins. And in this patient's bone marrow, it shows kappa amyloid human light chain, 12 kilodaltons. Remember that an intact light chain is 25 kilodaltons. So here again, you've only got half of the light chain, and it matches with 100% sensitivity. And of course, as often is the case in these specimens, there's a little bit of albumin, apolipoprotein E, vitronectin. Those come along with it, as does serum amyloid P component, which is typical for all amyloid deposits. But we're confident this is a kappa-free light chain. This is a patient who had a sural nerve biopsy. Again, H&E shows a fascicle with amorphous eosinophilic material. By Congo red, it's clearly conchophilic. Here we're doing the laser dissection of the tissue. We subject it to the mass spec, get the peaks. We find this amino acid sequence here. And the library pulls up immunoglobulin kappa variable 3, and it matches the sequence exactly. And so we've taken this turnaround time now of about a day, day and a half, to verify the type of amyloid protein that we're dealing with. And I'll give you examples of problems later. So this is a patient of mine. He was a 74-year-old man with chronic lymphatic leukemia. 10 years ago, he was treated with fludarabine for the chronic leukemia. In April of 2005, he developed carpal tunnel syndrome. We stained the carpal ligament because of his CLL. It was Congo red positive. But we did nothing because all he had was carpal tunnel syndrome. But 3 years later, he developed heart failure. We did an echo. The echo showed infiltrative cardiomyopathy. His serum had a small G lambda protein. His urine had a lambda. and he had an increase in free light chains, lambda. He had an elevation of B natriuretic peptide, indicative of cardiac failure, and his bone marrow showed amyloid deposits. So I talked to the patient, you have CLL, you have heart involvement, you have lambda light chains, we're going to give you chemotherapy to destroy the lambda light chains. 3 days later, the pathologist calls me because they did mass spec on the bone marrow Congo red. And what they found was that instead of showing a lambda light chain, it showed transthyretin protein in the bone marrow as the subunit of the amyloid. And transthyretin is not immunoglobulin light chain or primary amyloidosis. That's what you see with inherited amyloid and with senile cardiac amyloid in the 74-year-old with heart failure. And when we did gene sequencing of TTR, there was no mutation, so this wasn't an inherited form of amyloid. So this clearly had to be senile systemic or senile cardiac amyloid, and the CLL was completely incidental, and chemotherapy would provide no benefit to this patient. So in this case, my clinical judgment was wrong, and the pathologist saved me from inappropriately prescribing chemotherapy to a patient with non-light chain amyloid. Senile cardiac amyloid is overwhelmingly seen in men, has a much better prognosis than light chain amyloid. It is exclusively manifest in the heart, although half of the patients with senile cardiac amyloid have carpal tunnel syndrome. So it's a tricky distinction. You have heart amyloid, what is the type? Prognosis is much better, 5 to 6 years. It's an increasing problem. If you look at autopsy specimens in the United States, patients over the age of 80, 12% have significant amyloid deposits in their heart. And now that tafamidis has been released for the treatment of TTR amyloid neuropathy, the question comes up whether it will have benefit in TTR cardiac amyloid. So studies are starting up to look at that. This is another patient that basically underwent mass spec. And what we found, instead of a normal wild-type transthyretin with a single peak that you would expect in senile amyloid, you get a double peak. And that double peak shows two proteins, one, of course, produced from each of the chromosomes. This patient has inherited amyloidosis, the VAL30 MET variety, the type typically seen in Portugal, Sweden, and Japan. And then this patient has the native TTR, the type that is seen with senile cardiac amyloidosis. And the technique is sensitive enough to actually show the molecular weight difference between the mutant TTR and the native TTR because of the substitution within one Dalton. How do we monitor amyloid? That's changed a lot in the last 7 or 8 years. In the old days, we used to be able to monitor amyloid very poorly. We do serum electrophoresis and serum immunofixation and urine electrophoresis and urine immunofixation. Those are very poor techniques because in amyloid, the monoclonal proteins are very small. They're hard to quantify. They're hard to see changes. It's common for amyloid for patients to have M spike in the serum of 2 or 3 or 4 grams per liter, which is barely measurable. In the urine, the problem is there may be light chains, but most of these patients, they have renal involvement or they have heart failure, and there's lots of albumin in the urine, and it's hard to see the peak. But when the light chain assay was introduced, the immunoglobulin-free light chain assay, which is a nephelometric technique, it really transformed our ability to monitor the activity of a patient's amyloidosis. The light chain technique has become so useful for us that we no longer are required to measure 24-hour urine light chains, which is a big convenience for patients. And many laboratories do not like processing 24-hour urines. So we no longer feel it's required in myeloma, Waldenstrom's, Mugus, smolderers, plasmacytomas, or POEM syndrome. The only time we really feel a 24-hour urine is required when a light chain is done is in the presence of either suspect amyloidosis or suspect kappa immunoglobulin light chain deposition disease. And we use the light chain a lot. We use not the ratio. We do not use the ratio of light chain. We use only either the involved light chain levels, the absolute levels, or the difference between the involved and uninvolved. We don't use the ratios. They're too labile because the uninvolved light chain can be very, very small, and very tiny changes can cause very profound changes in the ratio. So we warn against the use of the ratio, even though the company talks a lot about the ratio. Using the light chain, advantages are a couple. First of all, more patients become evaluable for response. And it also better predicts the outcome and the survival compared to looking at the M spike by standard serum protein electrophoresis. You know, we used to say in the old days that with melphalan and prednisone, the response rate in amyloid was 15%. Yet with melphalan and dexamethasone, the response rate can be 50%. Can the difference between melphalan and dexamethasone and melphalan and prednisone be so profound? I don't think so. I think it's just that when we used melphalan and prednisone in our Mayo studies, we never had the light chain to measure response. So patients were called non-responders because we couldn't evaluate. And so the light chain has been tremendously helpful. And now these light chains have been incorporated into a new response criteria for amyloidosis. Patients who are non-responders, of course, don't get a 50% reduction. Partial responders have a 50% reduction in the difference between involved and uninvolved. Again, we're not looking at the ratio. It's not part of the response criteria. We've incorporated a new very good partial response, which is basically a difference less than 40, and finally complete response, which is normal levels of involved and normal ratio. This is just the validation set that we looked at a three-month landmark and a six-month landmark, looking at what impact response has on survival in amyloid when response is measured by the light chain. And what we find is that the criteria are useful. Having a partial response in amyloid improves survival. Having a very good partial response in amyloid improves it even further. And if you can get a complete response to amyloid, then survival is very, very good if there's not advanced end organ damage. We also have new organ response criteria for amyloid. And I wanted to just mention the two most important, the heart and the kidney. And the reason for it is that we used to measure heart response by echocardiogram. We found that the echocardiogram is not reproducible as a response criteria. Every cardiologist gives you a different result for ejection fraction, septal thickness, diastolic parameters. And so they weren't reproducible. And therefore, when we looked at echo's impact on survival, it wasn't nearly as good as simply looking at the NT-pro brain natriuretic peptide and the troponin level. Those two measures, troponin and BNP, were all we really needed to know about outcomes with the heart. Basically, the new criteria don't look at echo, but just looks at for response, it's a 30% decrease and a 300 nanogram per liter decrease. That's a cardiac response. Cardiac progression is a 30% increase in NT-proBNP and a 300 nanogram increase, or New York Heart Association response. That is predictive. The kidney criteria have not changed, 50% reduction in urinary protein. Liver criteria, 50% reduction in ALK-FOS is how we assess organ response. So the big new thing is echo is out. Cardiac biomarkers are in for the assessment of response and progression in cardiac amyloid. When we talk about prognosis in amyloid, it's only a question of how your heart is. If you show up with a bad heart, it's a bad outcome. And if you show up with a good heart, it's a good outcome. When you look at patients who present with renal amyloidosis, the most common cause of death in renal amyloid is cardiac amyloid. The most common cause of death in liver amyloid is cardiac amyloid. And the same for peripheral nerve amyloid. Obviously, there's exceptions, but the driver of outcome is how is your heart. The more advanced the heart involvement, the worse the outcome is going to be. And how we measure the heart has changed. When I first started, heart failure meant you came into the emergency room with orthopnea, you had cardiomegaly, pleural effusions, curly B lines. That was heart failure. If that was the definition of heart failure, median survival was 30 days. 30 years ago, echocardiography was introduced, and now we can measure wall thickness, ejection fracture, Doppler filling, strain. That's refined, given us new parameters to measure and a more accurate way of assessing cardiac amyloid. But as we got more sensitive, the survival improved from 1 month to about 8 months. Doppler measures, which measured the filling, the amount of stiffness of the heart, refined it further. That added now the deceleration time to the echocardiogram. And as a consequence, we could get more refined. 10 years of MRI investigations, MRI characteristic subendocardial enhancement can diagnose amyloid and is prognostic. Strain was added to the echo 5 years ago, but cardiac biomarkers really are the key measures, simple blood-based measures for the status of amyloid. Initially, we used the NT-proBNP with the troponin in order to develop a staging system for amyloidosis that divided patients into three categories. But you'll notice the three categories had survivals of 4, 10, and 26 months. We see a pretty serious population with amyloid with very poor outcomes, far inferior to multiple myeloma. And this is not related to the year. You can see that in this graph, we've been getting better with amyloidosis over the years, and that between 1967 and 1997, the median survival is improving. But what isn't improving is that in amyloid, 40 years have occurred, and we still have 40% of our patients die the first year. Even with our sophisticated everything, we're still diagnosing cardiac amyloidosis way, way too late, and we still are unable to affect the outcome in a very substantial proportion of patients. When we look at outcomes in systemic amyloid that have Mayo stage 3, which means they have high troponin and high BNP, what we find is that the treatment responses of everybody are very poor, and even patients who have deep responses still have poor problems. So really the answer is, until we start diagnosing cardiac amyloid earlier, we're not going to impact the outcome in this disease. Our overall survival was only 7 months in all of our cardiac stage 3 patients. This is recent data, so still patients do poorly. And if patients had a high elevation of the NT-proBNP, median survival was 3 months. So we've really got a problem. We think we've improved the criteria. First, we used only cardiac biomarkers, troponin and BNP, but then it became clear that the light chain level, the involved light chain level, actually predicted outcome. And as a consequence, we then started to first look at adding to the BNP. We started looking at, once we validated that, we started looking at the light chain levels. I'll get to that. Here it is. Here we now have added a light chain level of 18 milligrams per deciliter or greater than 180 milligrams per deciliter for the difference between involved and uninvolved. And we give a point for each criteria. 1 point for the high light chain, 1 point for a high troponin, 1 point for a high NT-proBNP, and you get four groups, 0, 1, 2, and 3. And what we can see is that we get very dramatic differences in median survival from less than a year to about 5 year median survival. And so this was published just earlier this year. And so now we're using troponin, BNP, and the free light chain difference. And that is very helpful for us for discussing with our patients what their anticipated outcomes are likely to be. I'll finish up by talking about therapy. So I think the standard of care still, that is a moving target, but the standard of care is still melphalan and dexamethasone. Everybody can take it. It's all oral therapy. Even patients with advanced disease who you don't expect to do well can take oral melphalan and dex. You can take it no matter what your creatinine is. You can take it even if you have GI involvement. And depending on the patients that you see, In Pavia, Italy, median survival with melphalan and dexamethasone is 5 years. Of course, that's not what everybody sees. Others have reported survivals as short as 12 months in Heidelberg, Germany, but they saw a much greater proportion of cardiac amyloid. The British use cyclophosphamide, thalidomide, and attenuated dexamethasone, one of the first additions of a novel agent to an alkylator-steroid combination. And they also reported very good outcomes, median survivals as much as 8 years. And these are tolerable doses. This is cyclophosphamide 500 milligrams orally once a week. Dexamethasone was given in this 20 milligrams days 1 through 4. And the thalidomide was started at 50 milligrams a day and escalated in 50 milligram increments to get to a maximum dose, if possible, 200. Although in my experience, you don't get much beyond 100 for most patients. Melphalan, dexamethasone, and lenalidomide has been used in amyloidosis. In a phase 1 dose escalation trial, the following dose of melphalan and dexamethasone was used. Notice that this melphalan dose is not the dose that you use in myeloma. In myeloma, your melphalan dose is 0.25 milligram per kilogram per day. Here we're reducing the dose 1/3 for amyloid patients, which is completely appropriate because the population is so much more fragile, they cannot tolerate the same therapy myeloma patients can. Low molecular weight heparin was used to prevent DVT from lenalidomide. They found that the maximum tolerated dose was 15 milligrams of lenalidomide. They had a 58% overall response rate with a 2-year event-free survival of 54% and a 2-year overall survival of 81%. So clearly, IMiDs have the potential to play a significant role in the manage of amyloid. We love to do stem cell transplants at Mayo Clinic. We think stem cell transplant is a terrific technique. In fact, even though most transplants in the United States, autologous, are done for myeloma, amyloid's a much better model for transplant than myeloma is. First of all, the cells, the tumor burden tends to be much smaller than myeloma. The proliferative index is almost always zero compared to myeloma, where half the patients have kinetically active cells. 25% of myeloma patients have unfavorable genetics, proliferative genetics, 414, 1420, 1416, and P53. You don't see that in amyloid. So in terms of thinking about a model for high-dose therapy, I can tell you that amyloid, and for that matter, Waldenstrom's, are much better experimental models than myeloma is, and you can expect transplanting an amyloid is like transplanting an MGUS. Because these cells don't divide, so you kill them once, they're going to stay killed for 5, 8, 10 years, not myeloma 2, 3. And so right now, we're running a 94-month median survival. The problem, of course, is the patients are fragile. They do not tolerate this therapy, so you have to be very, very selective. So to be honest, of all amyloid patients we see, we transplant between 20 and 25%. The rest are too old, or have too much renal insufficiency, or have too much cardiac involvement, and the risk is excessive, and we reject them for therapy. This is just an example of looking at the outcome of an actually pretty typical patient after a stem cell transplant. Here you're looking at the patient's urinary protein loss. Here you're looking at the patient's serum albumin in a patient with renal amyloid nephrotic syndrome. And here you can see that before transplant, the patient was spilling 4 grams per day. At 6 months, this patient was evaluated as a non-responder to therapy because the urinary protein was only 3.5 grams and the serum albumin was still suppressed, 18 grams per liter. But because organ responses are slow and because this patient had a hematologic response at 3 months, we waited. And by 3 years, the patient had a normal urinary protein loss and a serum albumin of 37 grams per liter. And so transplant really plays an important role for selected patients. Bortezomib clearly has activity. The problem is it's difficult to know where it goes. This is the study from the Princess Margaret Hospital, a collaborative study of bortezomib and dex. And what it showed is that untreated patients had a 47% complete response rate. Cardiac responses were 29%. Hematologic responses correlated with an organ response with a high one-year survival and cardiac biomarkers predicting survival. However, these patients were selected. Patients with New York Heart Association class 3 and 4 were excluded from participating in the study, knowing that bortezomib has some cardiotoxicity and can precipitate heart failure. So this is not representative of the entire spectrum of amyloid disease. If you exclude all the 3 and 4 heart failure, you already have a very, very good group you're dealing with. We do like CyBorD. That's a Mayo Clinic favorite. We use CyBorD for myeloma, CyBorD for amyloid, R-CyBorD for Waldenstrom's. And the combination of cyclophosphamide, bortezomib, and dexamethasone does show activity. That doesn't make it first-line therapy, but it has activity. We use the bortezomib once a week with much lower neurotoxicity. We reported earlier this year on 17 patients, very, very rapid responses. 58% had symptomatic cardiac involvement and 94% response rate and a 71% CR rate. And because we don't know how durable a response to bortezomib-based therapy will be, we actually took 3 of the patients who we thought were not candidates for transplant. They got better, and we transplanted them. We use it as an induction step. This is a current study that's still accruing in Europe and the United States. It compares melphalan dexamethasone with melphalan dexamethasone bortezomib. This is actively accruing patients who are ineligible for transplant, but this study excludes stage 3 cardiac amyloid. So the most severe, the patients most in need of help cannot participate in this study. So we really won't know how we're supposed to deal with the most advanced and the most sick. Lenalidomide and dexamethasone is highly active in amyloidosis. When we treated patients, we started with 23. As often is the case, 40% of the patients died within the first 6 months of treatment, as it always does. But those patients who made the 6-month landmark had a significant hematologic response. 10 of the 12 who survived 6 months responded. So lenalidomide dex is active. Just published this year, looked at amyloid as second-line therapy with lenalidomide dex, patients who failed melphalan and bortezomib, and so they were treated with lenalidomide dex, and they failed both alkylator and proteasome inhibition, and so looked at this as salvage. In 24 patients, 19 were previously refractory to thalidomide, 2 died and were inevaluable for response, and a high treatment-related toxicity, but despite their heavily pretreatment and the fact that they were refractory, in those patients who were diagnosed within 18 months, the hematologic response rate was 41%. Median overall survival of all 24 was 14 months. So it becomes an option if the drug's available and patients have failed standard therapies. Just mention a little bit of pomalidomide. We've explored its use in the treatment of amyloidosis. As you know, pomalidomide is a third-generation immunomodulatory drug with activity that kind of combines thalidomide and lenalidomide, but is 10 times more potent mole for mole, because where the dose for thalidomide would be 150 milligrams, the dose of lenalidomide would be 15 milligrams, the dose of pomalidomide would be 1 or 2 milligrams. So it's quite a bit more potent. And to make a long story short, pomalidomide dex in patients with previously treated amyloidosis produced a response rate of 48%, fast responses, organ responses, and an overall and progression-free response rate of 28 and 14 months median, with a one-year overall survival of 76%. So pomalidomide, I think, has some activity. We have not explored the use of bendamustine. We have not looked at carfilzomib yet in the treatment of amyloidosis. Obvious questions. We have done heart transplant for our patients with amyloidosis, patients who have only heart involvement, who are eligible to be treated with chemotherapy to produce a complete response. We've treated 23 such patients with heart transplant, young people though. Old people in our country can't get a heart. Most people can't get a heart. Although we've given now one artificial heart, actually, to a patient with amyloid light chain disease. Median time on our wait list was about 4 months. And 12 of them went to stem cell transplantation after cardiac transplant. We've reported on those patients. 2 died early, 10 of them survived. However, 8 of the 10 eventually died of progressive amyloid, although some of them were longer term survivors. 2 are still alive at 93 and 148 months. This is not nearly as good as heart transplantation for idiopathic cardiomyopathy, but these are patients who almost certainly would have died otherwise. And that's the Kaplan-Meier survival curve of the patients transplanted for cardiac amyloid. You can see that the 5-year survival is about 50%. Native heart disease, 5-year survival is about 85%. So I'm going to summarize. What do you do when you see a patient? If you suspect amyloid, you shouldn't do a biopsy. That's not the first thing you should do. The first thing you should do is an immunofixation of serum, urine, and a free light chain. That's what you should do to screen. Because if it's negative, it's very unlikely that they have light chain amyloid and you should drop it. Don't go any farther. But if it's positive and they have a compatible clinical syndrome, dyspnea, weight loss, edema, proteinuria, peripheral neuropathy, hepatomegaly, then those patients should have Congo red staining of fat and bone marrow. We do not do this routinely in our myeloma population. We're not interested if they don't have a syndrome. If the biopsy is negative, there's a 17% chance that they still have amyloid. So you have to decide how strong the index of suspicion is and do an organ biopsy if you want to. If it's positive, you want to be sure that it's systemic amyloid, not localized amyloid. If the patients have systemic light chain amyloid, localized amyloid, it's local therapy. Always ask your pathologist who gives you a positive Congo red, could this amyloid be transthyretin, fibrinogen, amyloid A, beta 2 microglobulin, apolipoprotein, lysozyme, many different types of amyloid. You need to be sure about that. If you're sure, then clearly the patient is a candidate for systemic chemotherapy, either high dose or moderate dose. This is our MSMART criteria. You've probably heard about this before at MSMART.org. But basically, what we're looking for in a transplant eligible patient is a 90% reduction in the free light chain by 6 weeks or 3 months. If they don't achieve it, second line post-transplant is bortezomib based. If the patient does achieve a very good partial response or better, we will not treat them any further. For transplant ineligible patients, first line is melphalan dexamethasone. Depending on their risk, we'll give them either 3 months or 6 months to respond. Second line therapy for us is bortezomib based therapy. When a person's relapsed or refractory, you can do almost anything because there's just no data to decide what's the correct treatment. So bortezomib dex, Cybor-D, Mel-Dex, melphalan bortezomib dex, melphalan prednisone, lenalidomide, thalidomide, no one knows. So let me sum up. For treatment, patients who can be transplanted should be transplanted. For patients who can't be transplanted, for patients who can be transplanted, melphalan and dexamethasone still are standard. Bortezomib is highly active. How to integrate it into practice isn't defined. IMiD therapy, including CTD, melphalan dex, lenalidomide. Lenalidomide dex is currently being explored. I think that's a good place for me to stop on an exhausting talk and maybe just turn back over to you. Should I take questions? Take a break?
If you allow me to welcome our guests, but before I will do it, I would like to introduce yourself. Already you did so very effectively, but I would like to say that Professor Murray Abraham Gertz is a very distinguished American scientist head of Internal Medicine Department Institute in famous Mayo Clinic in Rochester. We have heard already Rochester is a small town, about 100,000 inhabitants. Opposite to Toronto, we have heard already about Princess Margaret Hospital, which is over the lake. And I think that you did the best introduction of yourself. We learned that hematology, especially amyloidosis, but not only, is really internal medicine subject. We have heard about cardiac involvement, kidney involvement, other tissue, and it's so important to see not only from pure oncologist or hematological point of view, but whole medicine. I would like to tell that. To tell you that in this working Sunday here in Kraków, a lot of guests came from different parts of Poland. I see people who came from Gdańsk, from Olsztyn, from Lublin, from Gliwice, remind me from where? From Łódź, of course, from Łódź, central Kraków. You see, so it only shows how Polish hematologists are not only active and intensive in their research, but how they decided to come on the Sunday to hear your talk, but also to meet each other. I think it's so important that our medical field is our most important and valuable challenge in our life. So saying this, I think that we'll remember your visit. I'm very grateful that you came very long way from America to Kraków only for a few days. And as we are talking today, Kraków is the place of the oldest Polish university, the oldest Polish hematology department. We recently celebrated 60 years, 1950. This department was set up with very important and strong hematological profile, although it was internal medicine department. But our head procedure Aleksandrowicz were involved in hematological studies in pre-war time, and here in Kraków the first Polish textbook was hematological textbook was published in 1946. The first hematological congress of Polish Hemat Society took place here in Kraków in 1950, and the first allogeneic bone marrow transplantation were performed here in 1958 without knowledge of HLA antigens, because it was done between two twin sisters in CML. So welcome to Kraków, the oldest Polish medical center from 14th century. We are very old, but we try to be modern, you know, and sophisticated in medical field as well. Once more,
thank
welcome.
You. It's a great honor to be here. Do you want to have a minute for questions or a little?
Just afterward, because it's.
We can do after.
Okay. You have a lot of stamina.
Can I ask a question? It's not or not. Regarding the based on your extensive experience relating to the diagnosis of amyloidosis, could you tell us what is the natural course of the disease? So the patient comes first to nephrologist, or they are seen by neurologist, or the cardiac involvement is at the end of the disease, or can it start? Because the main question is that, at least my feeling is in Poland, that those patients, they somewhere disappear before coming to our department. So the second question, which is related to this first one, is who should be taught? It means what kind of physician, cardiologist or nephrologist, how to, because if you do the urine electrophoresis, you may have the hint that the patient has, but you have to order this test first, because otherwise you cannot diagnose.
Right, so you hit on the real difficult question. Now, of course, most of these patients, think of a cardiac amyloid patient. They come with fatigue and breathlessness. Who are they going to see? Their primary care doctor. A primary care doctor, if you look at the incidence of amyloid, one primary care doctor maybe will see one patient in 35 years of practice. Maybe. If they see 300 new patients a year, they have the chance over 35 years to maybe see one amyloid patient. That becomes a problem. Now think of the amyloid patient. The patient, does the patient have cardiomegaly at early time? No, because the amyloid is stiff and restrictive. There's no cardiomegaly, it's poor filling. You don't even get a big cardiac silhouette. You get an EKG, it's either normal, atrial fibrillation, pseudo-infarct, go to the cath lab. No one picks up low voltage. No one sees the neck veins. It's a problem. The renal patient presents with edema. I just got for review a case report of a pregnant woman with light chain amyloidosis, but when she came with her edema, they checked her. She had proteinuria, no immunofixation. She's diagnosed with preeclampsia and missed. How many patients go to the neurologist with their peripheral neuropathy and get immunoglobulin infusions or plasma exchange or Rituxan before they come to see you? So you hit on the problem. How do you have the index of suspicion? And maybe I should talk the first half to the general internist about when to be suspicious for amyloid. I think for this audience, the big deal is your atypical myelomas or your myelomas who have a lot of symptoms or a lot of weight loss, which is not typical for myeloma, who have things other than anemia, renal insufficiency, or bone pain or bone lesions, because amyloid patients rarely have them. I think that's probably the best. But that is, I think, why 40% die in the first year. The diagnosis isn't made early. It's just rare. It's not within the realm of experience of most physicians. All right. So I'll talk a little bit, about Waldenstrom's macroglobulin, the rarest, the one that's 2,000 per year. Again, here I've shown this. Now, keep in mind that IgM monoclonal proteins are 1 in 6 monoclonal proteins, more common than IgA monoclonal proteins, more common than light chain proteins, second only to IgG. So think of it this way. If you look at the adult population and 3% have a monoclonal gammopathy and 1 in 6 is IgM, that means 1 in 200 patients over the age of 50 has an IgM monoclonal protein. More common than having abnormal cervical cytology, more common than having thyroid disease, 1 in 200 IgM monoclonal proteins. And again, in our practice, Waldenstrom's only comprises 2% of the 34,000 period that we saw over a period of 50 years, so it still remains very, very rare. And of course, here's your typical hallmark. Here you have your cellulose acetate electrophoresis showing a dense albumin band with Pont-Sol-S, alpha-1, alpha-2, beta, and a big dense gamma spike. Here's your immunofixation strip showing a band that's slow migrating. It's polyclonal G, but clearly has an M-kappa component. Cells on a right-stained bone marrow that are not plasma cells. These are clearly not exactly plasma cells, but they're not exactly small lymphocytes either. This is classically lymphoplasmacytic morphology, more cytoplasm than a CLL cell, deeper blue, a little perinuclear clear zone present, but not the eccentric nuclear chromatin pattern of a plasma cell. And then, of course, the finding of hyperviscosity with retinal hemorrhages present due to the shear force of the viscous serum. When we talk about Waldenstrom's, we break that down into 4 separate groups. Number one, and the biggest one, is IgM muggis. They have an IgM monoclonal protein. They're not allowed to have anything else. We have patients who have smoldering Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia, the counterpart of smoldering myeloma. Patients who have an IgM monoclonal protein and their bone marrow fulfills criteria for lymphoplasmacytic lymphoma, but they have symptoms neither related to tumor mass nor symptoms related to the IgM. The third are those patients who have problems because of the IgM monoclonal protein, not because their marrow is infiltrated, not because of hepatosplenomegaly or lymphadenopathy or B symptoms, but they can have a very small tumor clone in the marrow, but they have a very dangerous monoclonal protein. This can produce cold agglutinin hemolytic anemia when it binds to the red cell. It can cause type 2 mixed cryoglobulinemia. It can cause anti-myelin-associated glycoprotein, anti-MAG neuropathy, and it can cause IgM amyloidosis. So those are patients who have symptoms related to the IgM, not so much to the marrow. And finally, your classic Waldenstrom's, who has symptoms of tumor infiltration, almost exclusively cytopenia, and may or may not have significant marrow infiltration or IgM-mediated symptoms. Now, when we talk about therapy, I can tell you I'm not very aggressive in this disease. You'll hear much about bortezomib, bendamustine therapy, everolimus therapy, AKT inhibitors, and they're all active in Waldenstrom's, but please keep in mind, this is not a disease of children. Average age 68, 70, median survival is 12 years, a lot of comorbidities, and as a consequence, half of the patients actually die of diseases unrelated to the Waldenstrom's, and that becomes important in therapy selection. And by that, I guess I mean I don't want to have a patient who's going to live 12 years with intractable peripheral neuropathy, who can't sleep, who has to take gabapentin every night because of the neurotoxicity of induction therapy. The other thing to keep in mind is that responses in Waldenstrom's are very slow. They don't happen very fast. I get calls. I got a call on Thursday. The patient had a hemoglobin of 80 and an IgM of 4,200 milligrams per deciliter. The doctor treated the patient with a cyclophosphamide-based treatment, calls me back after three cycles and says, the IgM's 3,400 down from 4,200. It's only gone down about 20%. I said, what'd the hemoglobin do? He said, well, the hemoglobin's 110, up from 80. And I said, you treated the patient in the first place, why? Why? Well, because of the anemia. I said, it's fixed. I said, so let's not pay attention to the IgM number too much. It's not all about the number. You treated a patient for symptomatic anemia. You fixed it. That IgM for that patient is good enough. And so you have to be very careful about pushing for deep responses, because patients who have very minor responses actually can do very, very well as patients who have deep responses. And remember that some patients will take 6 months or more to show response criteria when you use either alkylator or purinucleoside analogs to treat their Waldenstrom's. For those patients who receive rituximab, it's important to know that after rituximab, the IgM level can go up, and that doesn't mean that the patient has progressive disease. Those calls I get too, the patient received rituximab, and now the IgM is rising. Should I give them bortezomib? Should I give them bendamustine? Should I give them cyclophosphamide? And oftentimes the right answer is, why don't you wait? Take your time. Let's see what happens in 2 to 3 months because of this flare phenomenon you need to be aware of. There is a staging system for Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia. This staging system is different from the IPI, it is different from the FLIPI. It includes five criteria: age, hemoglobin, platelet count, beta 2 microglobulin, and IgM. I'll say two things about this. Number one, no LDH. LDH is not part of the staging criteria for Waldenstrom's. Beta 2, much more important. Secondly, some people think that if an IgM level gets above a certain amount, we should treat them. If it's above 3,000 or 5,000. In fact, the staging system says it doesn't even change the prognosis until it's over 7,000 before it becomes important. And quite honestly, I've actually watched patients with Waldenstrom's with IgMs of 9,000 and 10,000 that were asymptomatic until they eventually did become symptomatic and initiated therapy. Age is such a profound factor that if you're over 65, you're automatically intermediate, period. Otherwise, if you have two of those five or greater than two, it changed. But look at these survivals, 12 years, 8 years, and 4 years. And all of this data was procured before 2000, all of it. So you don't have patients here treated with novel agents. So let's hope that we're actually going to have even a better survival. And when the disease is this indolent, avoiding toxicity associated with induction therapy is just as important as what's the highest response rate and what's the highest progression-free survival. This is the survival curves of the staging system, just to show the Kaplan-Meier that there's significant spread. It validates the staging system we use. So again, it's age, hemoglobin, platelets, IgM, beta 2 microglobulin. Couldn't be simpler. No imaging, no LDH. This is our favorite regimen. This is what we use for the primary therapy of Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia. Dexamethasone, rituximab, cyclophosphamide. This, in phase two, has as high a response rate as virtually anything that's been reported in phase two. Overall response rate is 83%. Time to response, 4 months, a flare in a third. But it's simple. The dexamethasone is 1 day, the cyclophosphamide is all oral, and then it's a question of rituximab availability. This is the Kaplan-Meier curves from those patients, time to progression and time to progression for responders, which I think is very, very good. 2 year progression-free survival, 78%, 2 year overall survival, 81%. This is a very good first-line regimen. Easy to manipulate, easy to control, and most of the toxicity is hematologic, so it's not a big issue. Purinucleoside analogs are very popular for the treatment of Waldenstrom's, and I think they're very, very good choices for older patients, patients who aren't going to be considered for stem cell transplant. But they are very myelosuppressive, and they are very immunosuppressive. You have to keep that in mind. You give a couple cycles of cladribine, and all of a sudden, the patient has a platelet count of 40,000 for 6 months. And the same for fludarabine. In addition, some pretty exotic infections, because these patients develop very, very low CD4 counts for a very long period of time. And so you can see, I've seen cryptosporidiosis, I mean, really some wild types of infections in patients who are purinucleoside analog treated. And questions have been raised as to whether or not purinucleoside analogs increase secondary MDS and increase the secondary emergence of large cell lymphoma, which is still responsible for the deaths of over 10% of patients with Waldenstrom's transformation. This is from that study in JCO looking at cladribine with Rituxan, just those two drugs, and you can see that the margins of error are wide because of the small numbers, but really 80% alive at 4 years. Inevitably, and it was just published earlier this year, treatment that's used effectively in chronic lymphatic leukemia is used in Waldenstrom. So here you have fludarabine, cyclophosphamide, rituximab, and this is reported in 43 patients. And you can see that the overall response rate for all patients is 80%. If you include stable disease, it's 89%, and that the event-free survival of responding patients is 4 years. So combining a purinucleoside analog with an alkylator in a non-fragile population is a very legitimate consideration. Bortezomib is active. There's no question about it. Responses of 83%, if you include minor responses, 91%. Median time to response is very, very fast. The IgM goes down quickly. The patient's hematocrit goes up quickly. But the neurotoxicity is unacceptable. Patients with Waldenstrom's have really significant underlying nerve problems to begin with, even if not symptomatic. And I really worry about first-line bortezomib in patients who I think have neurotoxicity rates that will run anywhere from 40 to 60%. It's a lot and not so reversible. This is a waterfall plot looking at the maximum decrease in IgM patients treated with everolimus, the treatment for metastatic renal cell cancer, also known as RAD001. And indeed, this oral agent, which is usually given in 5 to 10 milligrams per day, can cause very significant reductions in the median IgM. The waterfall plot showed reduction in IgM in all but two, and a objective response greater than 50% in nearly half of this refractory relapsing population of Waldenstrom. So I think everolimus as an all-oral agent with not very much toxicity other than what it does to lipid levels, they go up very, very high, I think has some potential to be incorporated in the future regimens treating amyloid, Waldenstrom's, excuse me. This is just a summary of stem cell transplantation for Waldenstrom's. I think that this is a badly underutilized technique. Just like amyloid, these cells are completely non-proliferative, rarely have adverse cytogenetics. They're almost all in G0. I think it's a great model for transplant. Curative? Of course not. But you can actually expect 4-year responses are pretty common with this. And if you look at patients that, this is from the European IBMTR, and you can see that the overall response rate here in patients reached 77%, and only a small proportion were failure to respond. So stem cell transplant, I think, is a bit neglected in Waldenstrom's, and certainly not for 70-year-old patients, but for patients diagnosed with Waldenstrom's at 55, 60, 63, 65, I think auto stem cell transplant is a very legitimate technique to think about. This is the Kaplan-Meier plot of overall and progression-free survival of the transplanted population in the registry. And you can see that the median progression-free survival is about 4 years. And I think that's pretty acceptable. Bendamustine is very, very active. The German lymphoma study group, in their large study of low-grade lymphoma that compared R-CHOP to R-bendamustine, had 41 patients in it who actually fulfilled criteria of Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia. And in an unplanned retrospective analysis, 22 received bendamustine, 19 received R-CHOP. Response rate was equal in both, but the progression-free survival for R-CHOP was 36 months. It wasn't reached with bendamustine. And the number of patients who relapsed was 18% in the bendamustine, 58% in the R-CHOP. So clearly, bendamustine has real potential in the management of Waldenstrom's. But of course, I'm not sure whether that's first line, second line, where it fits in. But the activity of bendamustine is clear. This is our consensus statement. This is our M-SMART for Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia. If the patient has either IgM muggis or no symptoms due to Waldenstrom's and no cytopenias, they should not be treated. There's actually very few patients that we treat with single agent rituximab. Why? Because the response rate to rituximab is about 55%. And everything I showed you with multi-agent drugs is 85 to 90%. And so if you can treat patients for a 55% response, I'm not sure they need a treatment very badly to begin with. And so for patients who have mild cytopenias, mostly for patients who have neuropathy or cold agglutinin disease, we'll use single-agent rituximab. But for the majority of patients who have significant anemia, significant thrombocytopenia, hyperviscosity or constitutional symptoms, we use plasma exchange only for hyperviscosity and only for a short period of time because that's just a holding pattern for cytotoxic drugs to be effective. If there is no hyperviscosity, then our first line is dexamethasone rituximab cyclophosphamide. For salvage therapy, it's a lot harder because there really is so poor data about how to manage patients who are relapsed. will often repeat the original therapy if they had a durable response. We think stem cell transplant should be considered at first relapse in selected patients, and then alternative first-line therapy. And of course, a lot of that is drug availability. If you got an alkylator, maybe you get a purinucleoside analog. If you got an alkylator and a purinucleoside analog, but you had a durable response, maybe you should repeat it. And if you don't have that, then the question is, what is the availability of bortezomib, rituximab, everolimus? I'll just talk a little bit about what we're doing in research at our center, just to get an idea about where we're headed as an institution. As I mentioned, rituximab, cyclophosphamide, dexamethasone is our standard of care. So what we're looking at for newly diagnosed patients is the institution of lenalidomide. MTD from the phase one portion was 20 milligrams per day, and so now it's LRCD for our newly diagnosed patient. This is a study that's being conducted at Mayo, and actually the first results will be reported at this year's ASH. For relapse disease, we have three different trials that we're looking at in Waldenstrom's. As I mentioned, bortezomib, rituximab, and dexamethasone does have high activity, 90%. And then the mTOR inhibitor, everolimus, mammalian target of rapamycin, everolimus is highly active. Temsirolimus is an analog that's available through NCI at no charge to patients. So we're combining bortezomib, rituximab, dexamethasone with temsirolimus, an mTOR inhibitor. We're also exploring R-Cyborg-D. We talked about Cyborg-D for amyloid, cyclophosphamide, bortezomib, dex. We're adding rituximab to that, and we're exploring that. And you'll notice that in both of these, the bortezomib is weekly. We don't, in this one, it's 1-4-8-11, but after the first few cycles, we go to weekly. And then finally, for patients who've exhausted conventional agents, our study is everolimus, RAD-001, and lenalidomide using the everolimus at 5 milligrams a day and the lenalidomide at 10 milligrams a day, just to have some sense of how we're managing our patients with Waldenstrom's. So I just thought I'd run through that. So while he's doing that, I can take a question. He must be getting exhausted. Go ahead.
Excellent talk.
Thank you.
Two questions that are related somehow. So in elderly people in whom we usually suspect amyloidosis, the MGUS prevalence is 5% or more. So we have to base on Congo stain. I would like to know how specific and sensitive this technique is. So we have two labs in our town, and one is giving a positive result, while other one almost all negative.
Yeah. I am sympathetic because, no, it's Congo red, even though it works very well in the hands of Dr. Virchow and Dr. Rakitansky. It's not that easy a stain to work with. It's easy to overstain, and so the Congo red gets trapped in the material. Collagen and elastin fibrils will pick up Congo red and will give you some birefringence, not classic green, but if you only see one every 3 months in a pathology, it's very, very difficult. So I'm sympathetic if the pathologist is uncomfortable. Our peripheral nerve lab for screening sural nerves use crystal violet for screening and then confirmatory. Our cardiac pathologists like to use sulfated alcyon blue first, and then we'll confirm with Congo red. Again, it's in the experience. For us, specificity is very high, but every year in my practice, I'll see two patients a year who really are completely crazy, and the doctor decided to do a fat aspirate, and it was positive. And they said, oh, thank God, I'm sending you to the Mayo Clinic. And I see them, and I say, no, you don't have amyloid. You are crazy, you know, because you get these false positives. It's the truth, but that's experience in the lab and the adequacy of the positive and negative simultaneous controls. We've actually, using the mass spec, What we're doing now is we're taking the Congo red positive fat or equivocal Congo red positive, and we're taking the and doing mass spec on it, looking for peptides. So if you look at it and out comes an immunoglobulin lambda light chain, it's not an accident. You've got amyloid. But if it comes out albumin, fibronectin, fibrinogen, collagen, that we use mass spec to say this is a negative fat aspirate. Yeah, it's absolutely not known. We've looked at germline gene usage. We've looked at immunoglobulin sequencing. And we don't know why the light chain is sticky to the kidney in this patient, to the heart in this patient, the heart and the kidney. We have no idea. And it becomes important because we see patients, for example, with renal amyloidosis, not a large number, maybe 15% of our patients. They get nephrotic syndrome. We treat them. The treatment fails. They end up on dialysis. And then they dialyze for 15 years, and they never develop cardiac, hepatic, nothing. They just become a chronic hemodialysis patient. And the light chain is still measurable, but it never turns into amyloid in other organs. We have other patients, the majority, who get renal amyloid, go on to renal failure, go on dialysis, and then 6 months later, the dialysis unit calls and says they're getting hypotensive on dialysis. Every time we do a dialysis run, their systolic pressure falls to 50. You look, and then they have about 4 months to live. We don't know why. It's a good question. Yeah?
In amyloidosis, you suggest to transplant, to perform autologous transplant in all patients up front, all eligible patients. Question is, do you have specific eligibility criteria for this population?
Yeah. That'll be in press and bone marrow transplant next week. We think the key, the serum troponin T has to be less than 0.06. We think the NT-proBNP needs to be less than 5,000. We think the alkaline phosphatase should be less than 3 times normal, and the serum creatinine ought to be less than 1.8. Manuscript is going to be in press very shortly. Proofs are done as we try to refine how to do it, because when you have bortezomib, and when you have lenalidomide, and when you have thalidomide, a 10% mortality with transplant, not acceptable anymore. 10 years ago, we didn't have those drugs. So if 10% of people succumb to a transplant, we did our best. That's no good now. We have to have a mortality rate of about 2%, which we can do with those criteria.
So. Mobilization is G-CSF alone, I suppose.
Well, I will just tell you that our mobilization for amyloid, myeloma, and Waldenstrom's is just G-CSF alone. We do not use chemotherapy to mobilize. Chemotherapy, we agree, increases the yield. You get more stem cells with cyclophosphamide, etoposide, whatever, will increase the yield. But we've looked, and it does not impact outcome. You don't get tumor mass reduction. You don't get deeper response. You don't get a longer progression-free survival. So it's just G alone.
Okay. And a third question is related to conditioning regimen, which is in your center, melphalan.
Yes, that's a traditional.
Myeloma-like.
Yes.
It's exactly the same. For multiple myeloma, we are now using an Divica sequence of total marrow irradiation using helical chemotherapy. And in a second transplant, it's high-dose melphalan. Now, I'm thinking if TMI could be appropriate for patients with amyloidosis. It seems to be much better tolerated. And if the disease is radiosensitive, it could be maybe a good choice for this patient.
Well, I think that's a terrific question and a terrific proposition. And it's true that we have not explored alternative conditioning regimens, but there's no question if the tolerance of it is good, because what's the melphalan dose with the TMI?
We use TMI alone?
Yes.
For the first transplant?
Only.
And melphalan alone for the second.
Got it. I got it. Okay.
Dissect the toxicity.
Yeah, I can't answer the question That sounds exciting. I just want to know, because I can time this. When do you want this to finish? 5?
I think 5:15.
5:15? You signal me. All right. All right. Multiple myeloma. You're familiar with that? We'll get to that. I picked 3 specific questions here, if we have time. You can't cover the whole field of myeloma. It's a whole day symposium. I want to talk about 3 things. 1, I want to talk about where's maintenance therapy today? And then I want to talk about induction therapy, triplet versus doublet induction therapy. And then if there's time, I'll talk a little bit about carfilzomib, pomalidomide, and elotuzumab. So I'm going to start first with maintenance therapy. Where does maintenance therapy sit based on the current data we have available? And before we can talk about the results of the clinical trials, we need to talk about what are the appropriate endpoints when we're evaluating the clinical trial. Now, when we're looking at treatments that are looking at drugs that are not commercially available, therefore patients either can get it on study or not get it at all, and we're trying to determine, does the drug have activity in the disease, then clearly relapse-free survival is a legitimate endpoint. If you look at how we developed thalidomide dexamethasone versus dexamethasone, lenalidomide dexamethasone versus dexamethasone, and of course bortezomib dexamethasone versus dexamethasone, relapse-free survival in a refractory relapsing population is a terrific surrogate for what we really want, which is overall survival. But if we're talking about maintenance therapy, and we're talking about patients who've achieved a response to treatment, and then some will receive treatment, and others won't receive treatment, and I tell you that the patients that received the treatment maintenance had a better relapse-free survival, I go, big deal. That cannot be a surprise that a patient who took a drug had a longer progression-free survival than a person who didn't take a drug. That makes no sense at all as an endpoint. Moreover, the questions come up, well, maybe overall survival isn't important if the patients on maintenance treatment had a better quality of life. If you live better on the treatment than not on the maintenance treatment, progression-free survival with a better quality of life during the period, I also think that's acceptable as an endpoint. So we'll look for those quality of life studies. Again, Thal-Dex, Bortezomib-Dex, Lenalidomide-Dex, pegylated liposomal doxorubicin, Bortezomib-Dex, all became approved and available to a desperate patient population based on progression-free survival. And that, of course, is appropriate. Because when you look at relapse disease, patients who have a longer plateau, a longer relapse-free interval, it does turn to overall survival. But let's think about progression-free survival in 2012 in myeloma. You have a patient who's in plateau, and they have an M spike, let's say, of 4 grams per liter. After a year, their M spike is 8 grams per liter. That patient has progressed. And now that's it. They have a, that's their, now their completed observation for progression. The average myeloma patient who goes from 4 grams to 8 grams doesn't know it. They're surprised. Oh, I don't know, I feel fine. I didn't know my M spike is higher. And this goes to the fact that unlike progression-free survival in colon cancer or in lung cancer where we see growing tumors, in myeloma where we have a tumor marker, a biochemical tumor marker that we're very sensitive in measuring, we will see changes that clearly mean the tumor mass is increasing and it means nothing to the patient. The patient is asymptomatic, doing fine, and in fact, often experienced clinicians appropriately will say, it's going up, but we're not going to treat you because you're doing well. We're going to watch you and let it go up a little farther, and then we'll decide what we want to do. And so when we talk about newly diagnosed patients on maintenance, I would argue that overall survival is your endpoint, as it was for melphalan prednisone bortezomib versus melphalan prednisone and melphalan prednisone thalidomide versus melphalan. Their overall survival drove it. The other question that you ask in a lot of these trials, particularly maintenance trials, is that when a patient who was randomized to the control arm progresses and is now off study, do they get the drug? In other words, saying that patients who took lenalidomide maintenance did better than patients who didn't get lenalidomide maintenance, the first question is, at the time of relapse, did those patients get lenalidomide? Because that's how you would do in standard practice. No maintenance, but at progression, you'd give them the lenalidomide. If they didn't access the drug, then there's a question about how valid the comparison is because they didn't get adequate salvage therapy. And we'll talk a little bit about whether in maintenance does progression-free predict overall survival. And as you'll see in 2 out of 3 studies, it didn't. We'll see. I will also show you that quality of life studies have not been done. We can show you progression-free and overall survival, but we can't tell you how patients are feeling on chronic maintenance therapy, whether that maintenance therapy was thalidomide, lenalidomide, or bortezomib. Then the question comes up, of course, what about patients on no maintenance? What is their frequency of diarrhea, skin rash, deep vein thrombosis, which we know to be side effects of these drugs? And finally, in patients that progress in the control arm, was the maintenance agent available? Because that's important in study design. If they didn't get it, you're not comparing maintenance versus no maintenance. You're comparing access to the drug to no access to the drug, and that's a very different outcome. The other thing, and I'll show that for the HOVON trial, whether the induction arms were identical. So if you use 2 different inductions, and then you use 2 different maintenance, and you get a different outcome, what does that prove? The inductions were different. And I have the HOVON data here. And we've been through this before. This is not the first time we've had this argument about maintenance. This is the talk I gave 20 years ago, looking at interferon, because everybody got interferon, because the Austrians said it was the best thing, and the Germans said it was the best thing, and Bart said it was the best thing, so we all had to do it. And the patients were miserable, and they were tired, and they were anorectic, and they had myalgias, but they had to take it because you would live longer. And where's interferon today? You know where it was. It was the rage. It was a passing fad. We've been through this. Do not make this mistake a second time. And you can see here, this is the meta-analysis from the British Journal of Hematology, again showing progression-free survival. Now, this overall survival is actually statistically significant because there's thousands of patients. But I will tell you that there is statistically significant, which is good for a statistician, and then there's clinically significant, which for a clinician, this, I'm not interested in treating 100 patients with interferon so that 2.5% of them will live, I don't even know how long, it looks like a survival curve for metastatic renal cell. So let's talk about thalidomide maintenance, because that's what we were talking about 8 years ago. The use of thalidomide maintenance after conventional chemotherapy. So there is no trial that compares thal versus no maintenance after the same induction therapy. What I've got is trials that use thal dex up front and thalidomide for maintenance. I've compared the VAD, vincristine doxorubicin dex, versus no thalidomide maintenance. It's very difficult in that kind of trial to say how much of the thal maintenance was maintenance and how much of it, of course, was induction. Maintenance experience with thal is provided by these trials. There were 7 melphalan prednisone versus melphalan prednisone thalidomide trials. 5 of the 7 used thalidomide maintenance after MPT, and overall survival was seen in 1 of 5. 4 of 5 did not show an overall survival benefit. Two of the trials didn't use stale maintenance after MPT, but overall survival was seen in both of those two that did not have a thalidomide maintenance. And I guess what I would conclude by looking at those seven trials is that thalidomide maintenance does not appear to be absolutely essential to improve the overall survival if thalidomide is part of the induction therapy. And so here I'm just showing you the maintenance results in non-stem cell transplant from the Jaimima, the Hovan trial, and the Nordic trial of MPT versus MP. And again, you can see much higher deep responses, much longer progression-free survival in two of the three studies, but the Nordic did not even show a median progression-free survival, and a median overall survival difference only in one study, the Hovan 49. What about maintenance thalidomide after autologous stem cell transplant? So you've got, obviously, the data from Arkansas, IFM, MRC, Australia, Princess Margaret, Hovan, and then US. And this is looking at thalidomide and very, very large studies. And in all of them, event-free and progression-free survival is clearly better with thalidomide. You just do better when your endpoint is progression-free survival. But when you start looking at overall survival, again, it changes. And again, when you look at the overall survival in the Little Rock data, there was a survival advantage, but only for patients who had abnormal metaphase cytogenetics at study entry. Standard risk patients did not benefit from thalidomide. No difference, no difference, no difference, no difference. Difference, I'll get to that, because it was compared with interferon, and no difference. And so you've got the majority of trials not demonstrating a survival advantage. Now, when we talk about the Little Rock data, one of the reasons why I think the majority, there was not a big difference or no difference in standard risk patients, that 83% of those patients received thalidomide at the time of progression. So they didn't get it as maintenance, but got it at progression, and now no survival advantage. So it wasn't required immediately post-transplant. In the IFM, only 62% received salvage thalidomide. That means that 38% of the patients never got thalidomide at any time during the course of their disease. And so then to conclude that thalidomide is superior for maintenance, I think is a little bit of a stretch, because so many patients never got exposed to a novel agent. And if that happens, what you're comparing is survival between patients who received the novel agent and patients who didn't receive a novel agent. And of course, that I would be willing to conclude is significantly different. And then in the Spencer trial from Australia, only 54% received salvage thalidomide. So basically, half of the patients in the control arm never accessed a novel agent. So I would argue that anything you tell me about survival makes no difference whatsoever. This is the Hovan 50 trial, and this was published 2 years ago in Blood, and it looked at, now again, look at the induction. Vincristine, doxodex, interferon, thalidomide, doxodex, thalidomide maintenance. Again, you're talking about patients who never received thalidomide at any time in the course versus patients who received thalidomide at induction and at maintenance. And of course, there are significant differences in depth of response, significant differences in event-free survival, but even with this, they could not demonstrate a significant difference in overall survival. This is from the MRC9 trial published in The Lancet last year by Gareth Morgan, looking at progression-free and overall survival according to maintenance randomization, just looking at thalidomide versus no thalidomide. Please remember that the patients received induction with cyclophosphamide, thalidomide, and attenuated dose dex, CTD. And progression-free survival was clearly different and quite significant in a very large study. Here's your median overall survival between the two. And in fact, it almost looks like the survival could be even a little bit lower with thalidomide. Now you could say, well, thalidomide's not the right drug. No one can tolerate thalidomide. For a maintenance drug to be effective, you need to be able to take it for a long time. So who can take thalidomide for a long time? Well, most people can't. And certainly if you're going to try and give them 100, 150, 200 milligrams, it'll be very few. So I think we, A, made some serious mistakes dosing the maintenance. I think that a maintenance dose of thalidomide is 50, tops. Otherwise, you're going to compromise your ability to continue it long term. If a person has to come off maintenance at 4 months because they have intractable neurotoxicity, what can you say about the value of the maintenance? Nothing. So we'll turn our much better drug, lenalidomide. We'll look at that. And of course, these three studies were all published in the New England Journal in the same issue, post-transplant maintenance lenalidomide, post-transplant maintenance lenalidomide, and this is a non-transplant. This is the MPR versus MP versus MPRR maintenance trial, Antonio Palumbo. And of course, we have three trials, all of which show an improved progression-free survival, which you should expect. But only one of the three show an improved overall survival. The et al. Study does not. The Palumbo study does not, which I'll show. And the three-year overall survival in McCarthy is statistically significant. So that's important, because we don't want to say lenalidomide doesn't, because this actually could be the keystone of treatment for myeloma. And so let's look at those trials. First of all, what toxicity do you get when you're on maintenance versus placebo? Because again, if it's not going to prolong your life, let it at least improve the quality of your life on lenalidomide. And here's what I can tell you. As you might imagine, lenalidomide patients had a significantly higher risk of grade 3-4 neutropenia and thrombocytopenia. But these infections are grade 3-4 infections, so you expect those patients are going to end up in the hospital. That's a significant morbidity. 4% of the patients, or three times as many, had deep vein thrombosis from the long-term IMID use. And then constitutional fatigue and skin problems, 12 versus 6%. So although quality of life studies were not done, at least we can say that the grade 3-4 adverse effects were substantially greater in the lenalidomide compared to the placebo group. And that was the et al. Study. This is the McCarthy study, comparing the toxicity of lenalidomide grade 3 and grade 4 between lenalidomide and placebo. Grade 3-4 hematologic was twice as common, but grade 4 non-hematologic was also a little bit of a concern in these patients. Second cancers. That's obviously a problem. Now, we can talk about SEER data, and we can talk about population-based measures of malignancy, and I can tell you those don't mean anything. The only thing that counts is a randomized trial that says you get it, you don't get it, and we'll look at the response rate, not 40,000 patients that are in the SEER database saying, well, the cancer incidence is only 2% anyway. That is not a valid measure. So let's look at the second malignancy rates in these patients. And this is from the et al. Study that led the French government to prematurely terminate the trial because of the higher incidence of second malignancies. And of course, this is a higher risk of second malignancy with no survival benefit in this study. And again, there's progression-free survival where the patient's M spike went from 5 to 10 or 10 to 15 versus getting pancreatic cancer or leukemia. Those are very different outcomes in terms of what the patient can expect. And again, this is only 2 years exposure to lenalidomide. So This is lenalidomide, AML versus MDS, but solid tumors were pretty significant. 4 versus 0, breast, kidney, non-melanoma skin cancer. Overall, 26 second malignancies out of 306, or 8.5%, versus just under 4%. So this is something that needs to be taken into account when we make a decision about it, because this was the study that didn't show survival advantage. And then when you look here, this is second primary cancer. So again, this of course is relapse of the myeloma, as expected, high relapse rates, unmaintained. This is relapse after lenalidomide. This is the death rate, which is significantly lower for the lenalidomide. But then here's the second cancer rate. And this spread here is second primary cancer incidence between the placebo group and the lenalidomide group at 50 months post-transplant. So that's not trivial. This is second primary malignancies now, summarizing the three studies. This is the et al. Study. Overall, 5.5%, placebo 1%. This is the McCarthy study, the CLGB, 6.5% versus 2.6%. And then this is the Palumbo study using maintenance lenalidomide, 3.1% versus 1.3%, which of course raises the question whether the risk is higher in transplanted patients than non-transplanted patients. The second issue that you should keep in mind is that in all of these studies, all patients received melphalan before they got the lenalidomide. So it doesn't really answer a question whether straight Len-Dex or increases the risk of a second malignancy. There may be an interaction with melphalan that's specific to the melphalan exposure. So you want to keep that in mind, not to throw the baby out with the bath water. And I would argue that based on these three studies, there likely is a small signal for second cancers that no SEER data and no population-based study can eliminate. What about maintenance therapy with bortezomib? Maintenance therapy with bortezomib has been used in three trials. The Mateus trial from Salamanca, Spain, the Palumbo trial, which was conducted in Italy, and Peter Sonneveld's HOVON study that was published just last month. And again, what we're looking here is bortezomib mel-pred versus bortezomib thal-pred. And here we're looking at bortezomib mel-pred thal versus bortezomib mel-pred no thal. And then here in the Sonneveld study, it was bortezomib, dexamethasone, doxil versus vincristine, doxil, dex. And what I'll show you, basically moving to the overall survival data, Mateus, no difference. Palumbo, no difference. Sonneveld, statistically significant difference in survival. So then the question is, oh, well then bortezomib maintenance is proven once every 2 weeks to improve overall survival. And here you can look at the two arms. In this, you can look at the progression-free survival in the HOVON study. And again, here is the statistically significant overall survival in the bortezomib maintenance arm, which is 78 versus 71%. So is bortezomib now validated as a survival advantage? Well, first of all, the HOVON study was not designed to evaluate the role of maintenance. There was no random assignment to maintenance. The only people who got bortezomib maintenance got induction with bortezomib. And the patients who didn't get bortezomib maintenance only got doxorubicin, vincristine, and dexamethasone. So there was never an intent to show a survival advantage attributable to maintenance. It's just that all of this arm did better than all of this arm. In other words, patients who got bortezomib sometime did better than patients who got bortezomib never. And that's a very big difference. And again, in this trial, none of the patients in the VAD arm had planned bortezomib, but we don't know how many got it as salvage. And again, bortezomib maintenance, patients had 3 cycles of bortezomib induction. And when you look at what happened after induction only, the CR rate was much, much higher in the bortezomib group. The CR plus NCR was much, much higher in the bortezomib group. And with those deep responses, one would anticipate a better outcome for those patients, but not necessarily because of the maintenance selected. In the study by Mateus, completion of bortezomib maintenance occurred in 47%, completion of thalidomide in only 27%, which goes to the fact that thalidomide maintenance isn't very feasible. People drop out a lot, and as a consequence, it's difficult to show differences. So concluding the maintenance, I don't want to be on the wrong side of this. I think it's very, very possible that as the McCarthy data matures, it'll be very clear that lenalidomide maintenance prolongs the survival of myeloma patients and will be recommended for all myeloma patients. But I would say if you were talking about that right now and saying we think that lenalidomide should be the standard of care for patients with multiple myeloma post-transplant, I would say you need to slow down and take a breath. I think that would be an unwarranted conclusion outside of a clinical trial. So that's that part. Breathe. I'll finish at 5:15. I'll stop with induction therapy, also designed to generate a little controversy. What is the right induction therapy? Two drugs, three drugs, four drugs? Maybe it really ought to be cyclophosphamide, lenalidomide, bortezomib, melphalan, dexamethasone, and elotuzumab. Do six-drug induction. Again, I emphasize that in a myeloma patient, the progression that we normally see in most patients is biochemical, asymptomatic, and not clinical. And then, of course, the question with doublet, triplet, or quadruplet induction is the same as it is for maintenance. Is survival better? Is quality of life better? Whether the therapy is started with this M protein or this M protein? And so this tandems into the discussion of maintenance therapy. If a patient gets four drugs versus two drugs, or two drugs but gets two other drugs at salvage, will that impact overall survival? And again, if you're talking about what's the best induction, I'm not convinced that the CR percent or the VGPR percent is the only thing we should be looking at, because what I'm interested in is living longer and living better by length of overall survival and quality of life data. So, when we talk about the best strategy, this is doublet induction and triplet induction. Now, if you fail triplet induction, of course, you're stuck because you kind of used up everything. If your triplet induction was bortezomib, thalidomide, dex, or bortezomib, lenalidomide, dex, at relapse, you're either looking at brand new agents or old agents. In doublet induction, of course, if you receive bortezomib dex and you relapse, you've never had thalidomide, or you've never had lenalidomide. Or if you receive melphalan, prednisone, thalidomide, you've never seen bortezomib. And so the question is, when you add at salvage the missing agent, how will that ultimately affect outcome? But one thing you can't compare in a clinical trial is triplet versus doublet, and then patients who relapse can't get the third drug. That's not how life really works. In real life, when you relapse after the doublet, you get the third drug. And if this study is performed in a country where access to drug number three isn't available, then of course you're going to get a survival advantage to the triplet. And so you have to look at how many patients will get salvaged. Well, the drug companies, of course, will say, well, that's not fair. By the time you salvage everybody, then survival is always going to be the same. Well, that's exactly the point. Why expose them early, the cost, the toxicity? If you salvage them with that missing agent, the survival will be the same. So I would argue that when you evaluate trials in newly diagnosed patients, the control arm, you have to have access to investigational agents at Prague. So let's look at a master trial, the VISTA trial of Jesus San Miguel, that compared melphalan, prednisone, bortezomib to melphalan and prednisone. In that trial, 338 patients were randomized to melphalan and prednisone. When those patients progressed, 130 received subsequent bortezomib. And the remainder, 62% of the VISTA patients who got melphalan and prednisone never got bortezomib. Maybe they relapsed quickly and they died, that sort of thing. But we're really saying that you live longer with bortezomib if you don't get bortezomib. But it doesn't prove that it's actually better than giving melphalan and prednisone as first line as long as you've got bortezomib for second line therapy. And this data is available in the article in the online appendix, not available in the print copy. Doublet regimens. We know that Fal-Dex, lenalidomide-Dex, and bortezomib-Dex are consistently better than vincristine, doxorubicin, and dexamethasone. There's no doubt in my mind that novel agent-based induction, although it may only be one novel agent, is better than not getting a novel agent at all. So it's important that somewhere along the line you get the novel agent. The question is, how many do you need up front? This is Vince Rajkumar's ECOG E4A03 trial at Len high dose Dex, Len low dose Dex, which proves that we can do very well with 1 year overall survival rates of 96%. And what it, of course, really proves is that high dose dexamethasone is a killer, cardiovascular deaths, pneumonia, PCP. So the question is, if we look at the doublets, Thal-Dex, Len-Dex, and Bortezomib-Dex, are these inferior to triplets, Bortezomib-Thal-Dex, Bortezomib-Len-Dex, and my Cyborg-D, Bortezomib-Cyclophosphamide-Dex? That's the key question. You see, it's good that the Celgene person couldn't make it. And again, what endpoint are we looking for? Are we going to be looking at relapse-free survival, or are we going to look at overall survival? So this is an MP plus regimen that Antonio Palumbo published. This is the MPRR, MPR and MP. This was the New England Journal article that was published. And you can see two things. This is really important. That, yes, maintenance lenalidomide did not improve survival compared to no maintenance lenalidomide. But the thing that no one talked about that drove me crazy is the survival wasn't any better than the MP arm. The survival was not better. Look at this. Now, obviously, it's clear that the melphalan prednisone patient must have gotten available salvage therapies. But at least it doesn't argue that even melphalan prednisone induction is inferior induction if you have access to salvage agents and you're looking at overall survival as the endpoint. Now, this is from Philippe Moreau and the IFM. This looks at progression-free survival at bortezomib-Thal-Dex versus bortezomib-Dex. And there's a clear, although not statistically significant, improvement in progression-free survival. Michele Cavo also showed a significant progression-free survival by adding bortezomib to the Thal-Dex, so showing that using the progression-free survival endpoint that the triplet therapy was better than the doublet therapy. But here's the published study with the survival. And this is cumulative overall survival looking at Thal-Dex and bortezomib Thal-Dex. And the overall survival published in Lancet, there's no survival difference, doublet versus triplet. So overall survival, 86 versus 84%. No statistically different survival in this group. What about transplant-ineligible patients? Transplant-ineligible patients, these are the two most commonly used triplets, melphalan, prednisone, thal, bortezomib, melphalan, pred, and non-melphalan-based are len-dex, bortezomib, cyclophosphamide-dex, and bortezomib-len-dex. See what we've got. So here we have three-year overall survivals. And overall survivals between the Facone study, the San Miguel study, which is the VMP versus MP, and the Raj Kumar Len Dex study. So we're just looking a little bit about what happens with time to progression and overall survival with novel agents. And initially, they actually look relatively impressive. But when you look at this study, which was done by Ruben Nizvetsky of Cornell, that is a large study, if you look at 502 patients that received, this is in the US, where everybody eventually gets access to bortezomib or thalidomide, and you look at bortezomib dex, bortezomib thal dex, and bortezomib MP, and this is not a published paper, this was just presented at ASH, the progression-free survival was not different in either of the three arms, and there are a lot in these arms. And what really struck me is that bortezomib, melphalan, prednisone, which is kind of a standard of care for non-transplant eligible induction, didn't appear to be better than bortezomib dex in this trial without giving them melphalan. Those of you who see a lot of these patients know that in an elderly population, melphalan's not an easy agent to give. A lot of cytopenias, a lot of protracted myelosuppression. They did quality of life studies. And this is the global health status score. So the higher you have it, the better is your quality of life. And what these two arms are not different, but what it does show is that the bortezomib thal dex had a significantly lower quality of life. So that, sure, they got a triplet combination, had a lower quality of life, and no benefit in terms of progression-free survival. This is Shaji Kumar's evolution trial. Four-arm study. It wasn't powered as a phase three, so I want to give you a little caveat there. It was really a randomized phase two study, but even so, there were reasonable numbers in each, and it compared three triplets, bortezomib dex lenalidomide, bortezomib dex cyclophosphamide, bortezomib dex cyclophosphamide with reduced dose, and then a quadruplet combination, bortezomib dex cyclophosphamide, lenalidomide, and here you can see there's no statistical significant difference in four arms. That's the only study I can actually quote you that looks at four drugs versus three drugs not showing any benefit. Gareth Morgan just published this year the impact of induction therapy on survival. And this, of course, comes from the Myeloma 9 trial. And he looks at progression-free and overall survival in the patients who received, non-transplant patients, where the two arms were cyclophosphamide thal dex, cyclophosphamide vincristine doxorubicin dex CVAD. And in that trial that was just published, there was no difference in progression-free or overall survival. And please note, we're talking 550 versus 540 patients in each arm. You're not going to get a bigger trial than that to try and demonstrate it. And so overall survival was not better in the subjects who achieved less than a CR or did it matter based on high risk or standard FISH. So we couldn't see anything. This study by Gardarette also compared the three-drug combination, bortezomib, thal-dex, and thal-dex, and looked at time to progression, progression-free survival, and overall survival. And so comparing the doublet versus triplet in the relapsed setting, this is relapsed disease, the superior progression-free survival did not turn into a superior overall survival. The p-value here is 0.1. And grade 3 neurotoxicity in the group that got bortezomib plus thalidomide was 29%, it was 12% in the doublet arm. So no overall survival advantage, significantly greater neurotoxicity. So I'm going to finish with this slide saying that if you use, again, overall survival as an endpoint, which I would argue is what's really important to our patient population, novel agent doublet therapy is not inferior to triplet as long as the third drug is available for salvage at the first progression. And that's how I'm, you know, people are asking me, what am I using for induction pre-stem cell transplant? Actually, I'm using lenalidomide dex. That's what I use. It's all oral. It's 4 months. It's one pill a day and 10 pills a week. And then I take them to transplant, and I get a blank stare. Really? You're not using Cybor-D, and you're not using VCD or bortezomib thal dex? And my answer is no, because I'm not convinced, despite two articles in Lancet Oncology, that using the survival point that I think is important, that I'm buying into triplet therapy over doublet therapy. And with that, I hope I will generate an argument. So thanks a lot. Yeah, it's enough.